What's up everyone, this is White Pointer bringing you a video version of one of my top 10 best published on game FAQs. This one is the top 10 different games with the same name on the SNES and Mega Drive. If you would prefer to read this list rather than watch it, the link to the written version is in the description. It may be hard to believe in the modern era of games where multi-platform titles are usually practically identical, barring some special exclusive features, but once upon a time, multi-platform releases were not actually guaranteed to be the same game, despite having identical titles. This was especially true during the famous battle between the SNES and the Mega Drive, that's the genesis for the North American viewers, where there were a surprisingly large number of cases. Unsurprisingly, this usually occurred with licensed games, as a publisher would secure the rights to an IP and then enlist the services of different teams, sometimes entirely different studios, to create a game for each of the major platforms. Other times, different publishers would secure the rights to publish games on different platforms. Why would different games with the same title release on different platforms? Often, this was due to different studios being given the job of designing and developing on each platform. Sometimes it was due to hardware limitations, sometimes it was due to various policies of the platform holder, sometimes it was for no discernible reason other than seemingly making them different for the sake of being different. This sometimes resulted in games across the two platforms being somewhat similar, but with a number of significant differences, such as different levels. Sometimes the games were in the same genre, but were designed very differently, and other times it resulted in games being completely different. You'd understand it really if we're talking about bringing a version of a console game to a handheld, but in the case of the SNES and Mega Drive, they were both 16-bit systems, so you wouldn't really expect too many games to have their differences, right? Yeah, wrong. With the Mega Drive boasting a faster clock speed and higher resolution, and the SNES offering more advanced graphics capability and better sound quality, it wasn't really a black and white comparison. So let's take a trip down memory lane and have a look at the top 10 games that appeared on both the SNES and the Mega Drive that had the same title but were actually different games. For the purposes of this list, I'm excluding games that were more or less the same, except for some notable differences. For example, while the SNES and Mega Drive versions of the original Mortal Kombat certainly had their differences, they were at their core still essentially the same game. The SNES just had the blood removed and some fatalities altered, whereas the Mega Drive didn't, so you won't find it or other games that had similar small differences on this list. This list is ordered as best I can to reflect just how different each of the versions were. The more different the games were between the two systems, the higher they place on the list. Sound reasonable enough? Which version of these did you own? Which version did you like more? Just to be clear, the goal of this list isn't to try to point out which was the better version of these games. The goal of the list is to point out just how different the versions were, and the ordering of the list is based on that. Let's get started! The early 90s were arguably when the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles really hit the peak of their popularity, and there were a number of very good video games, as well as some mediocre ones, produced featuring the heroes in the half-shell. One of the better games was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Tournament Fighters, a one-on-one fighting game that marked a departure from the side-scrolling beat-em-up games that the boys in green usually featured in. There were actually three completely different versions of the game, one for the SNES, one for the Mega Drive, and oddly enough, one for the NES, and even stranger is that unlike most other games on this list, Konami produced all three of them. The Mega Drive version featured 8 characters, including characters from the comics, April as a playable character, and an original character. Gameplay that was designed around the 3-button controller, punch, kick, and taunt, and original music. The SNES version featured 10 characters, including totally different characters from the comics, Shredder as a playable character, and a different original character. Gameplay that was designed around a 4-button controller, normal and heavy punches and kicks, and included an option to increase the game's speed. Both versions featured a super move system, although they were executed quite differently. On the Mega Drive, they could only be performed by executing a specific combination when the character was close to defeat, whereas on the SNES, the game included a separate gauge that built up during the match, and when it was full, allowed the player to execute the super move. This super meter system that was present in the SNES version was quite probably the first time such a system was implemented in a fighting game, although strangely, it was not present in story mode. Both versions featured a versus CPU mode, a 1v1 mode, and a story mode, although the story mode of each game followed a completely different plot, but still somehow had the same character as the final boss, Kurai, a character that had previously only appeared in the original comics. Each game also had a tournament mode, but once again, this was different between the two versions. So both games were one-on-one fighting games featuring the four turtles, but that's about the only thing they had in common. The SNES version is generally regarded as the better of the two, with the main criticism of the Mega Drive version being the unforgiving difficulty of the AI opponents. As mentioned, another completely different version of the game also came out on the NES, but this list isn't about NES games, so I'll just mention it here to say that it was decent for a NES game, but didn't compare at all to its 16-bit big brothers. You can probably be forgiven for not knowing what the Pirates of Dark Water is, so in case you don't know, it was a mostly unsuccessful Saturday morning cartoon by Hanna-Barbera that aired in the early 90s and ended quite suddenly after only 21 episodes. It followed the adventures of a young prince named Ren and his crew of allies as they searched for treasures that would stop the fictional world of Myrrh being consumed by an evil substance called Dark Water, while the pirate bad guys led by the warlord Bloth chased them. Unfortunately, the series was cancelled with the story unresolved and incomplete. Despite its short television run, it still managed to spawn video games published by Sunsoft. The Mega Drive game was developed by Iguana Entertainment, who would later go on to be best known for creating the Turok games, and the SNES game was handled by publisher Sunsoft's internal studio. Oddly, both games came out at least a year after the show's run had ended. The games did have some things in common. Both allowed the player to choose from one of the show's three main characters, both had an overworld map, and both had you fighting bad guy pirates. That's about where the similarities ended, though. The Mega Drive game was an action platformer with some minor RPG elements, requiring the player to jump, climb, and fight bad guys as they explored large levels to find the exit that often required the use of keys or other items to reach. The SNES version, on the other hand, was a pretty standard side-scrolling beat-em-up that didn't really do anything special to set it apart from all the rest. Despite the fact both games were based on the cartoon series, they both featured different stories. To be honest, neither game was particularly bad, but neither game was particularly noteworthy either, although the Mega Drive game did at least try something different and featured a password save system. No single 16-bit game is as hotly debated as Disney's Aladdin, with fans to this day still vehemently arguing about whether the Mega Drive or the SNES had the superior version. I'm not here to veto on that particular topic. You can debate that amongst yourselves. But the story behind the two versions existing is actually kind of interesting. Unlike most of the other games on this list where the different games still had the same publisher, that wasn't the case with Disney's Aladdin. The two games were in fact developed completely separately and independently of each other and published by two different companies, but still released at the same time. The Mega Drive version was published by Sega themselves and developed by Virgin Interactive. This was because Sega had not only obtained the license to the IP, but in the video game first, had also entered into a partnership with Disney's own animation studio. This partnership resulted in the developers Virgin Interactive collaborating with Disney animators to create the Mega Drive game, producing art and animation that looked like it had been taken straight from the film. Music from the movie was also arranged and included in the game. In terms of gameplay, the Mega Drive version was an action platformer, with Aladdin wielding a scimitar as his main weapon, while also being able to throw apples as a projectile. The game featured lots of secrets and bonus levels, and was generally more action-heavy. The SNES version, on the other hand, was developed and published by Capcom. This was because Capcom still held licensing rights to produce games based on Disney properties for Nintendo's consoles when the film came out. The SNES version has a distinctly different art style from the movie, and also featured some tracks from the movie, but not as many and contained more original music. This game was also an action platformer, but the big difference was that Aladdin didn't carry any kind of weapon, even though he was holding his scimitar on the box art, and instead defeated his enemies by jumping on them. Interestingly enough, the SNES version also used apples as a projectile weapon. This version of the game also contained secrets and bonus levels, and focused much more on precise platforming, as Aladdin possessed a much larger variety of acrobatic moves. Both games followed the general plot of the film, both had some different levels to spice up the gameplay, and both played on their main strengths very effectively. Both were critically acclaimed at the time, and both sold very well. The Mega Drive version went on to be the third best-selling game for the system, and the SNES version was Capcom's second best-selling SNES game. The movie Alien 3 wasn't as well received as its predecessors were, but that didn't stop it from spawning a ton of media, including, of course, video games. And there were a lot of video games. There were versions of Alien 3 released on the SNES, Mega Drive, Amiga, Commodore 64, NES, Master System, Game Boy, and Game Gear, and pretty much all of them were different. This list is about the Mega Drive and SNES versions, though, so let's compare the two. The Mega Drive version was developed by Probe Software and published by Arena Entertainment, while the SNES version was developed by Probe Software and published by LJN. On the surface, both games looked pretty similar. They both had you take control of Ellen Ripley with her buzz cut and tank top from the film in a platform shooter, as you climbed, jumped, and crawled through the levels while shooting the titular aliens. Both games followed the plot of the film pretty loosely, to be generous, although the SNES was slightly closer. Once you actually started playing them though, you'd realise they were actually very different. In the Mega Drive version, the basic goal of each level was to rescue prisoners within a time limit, with the player needing to explore the large areas to locate them with the help of a radar, and played pretty much like a traditional action platformer. The SNES version tasks the player with completing a variety of different objectives, such as sealing doors, fixing pipes, and destroying alien eggs. Did not have a time limit, featured a map, and actually played somewhat similar to a Metroid game. For the most part, the Mega Drive version concentrated more on action, keeping the game moving at a fast pace, in stark contrast to the SNES version that seemed to focus more on exploration and building up suspense and tension. They were ultimately two very different takes on the license, and both versions were well received by fans and critics alike. In fact, both games are regarded as being superior to the film they are based on, and once again, opinions on which is the better version are really divided. Ultimately, it really comes down to what style of game you prefer. What self-respecting kid of the 90s didn't love the Animaniacs? Created by Steven Spielberg, the cartoon was a skit-based show with lots of throwbacks to the old Looney Tunes cartoons, as well as modern references. It featured a lot of different characters, including Pinky and the Brain, Ralph the Security Guard, Slappy Squirrel, the Good Feathers, and of course, the Warner Brothers Yakko and Wacko and the Warner sister Dot. The show was hugely successful, and still maintains a very popular following many years after the show's run ended, so it should be no surprise that it spawned video games. At the time, Konami had the license to develop video games based on Warner Brothers properties, and so they created Animaniacs games for the Mega Drive and SNES, but of course, each system had its own version. Both of the games were bright and colourful, and captured the art style and animation of the show really well. Both also did a good job at reproducing the show's humour, and despite having different stories, both had the basic idea of visiting four themed movie studios that could be completed in any order to collect stuff while avoiding being caught by Ralph the Security Guard, before battling Pinky and the Brain as the final boss. However, the two games played very differently. On Sega's console, the game was a puzzle platformer, and you controlled one of the three Warner siblings, while the others followed behind, that each had a unique ability you needed to utilise to navigate your way to the exit of each level. Yakko had a paddle bat and could push boxes, Wacko had a hammer, and Dot could charm NPCs to make them do things, so the game allowed you to switch between them. On Nintendo's console, the game was a fast-paced quasi-3D platformer. That is, the game allowed you to move along a theoretical Z-axis, even though the game was 2D. That relied more on twitch-based reflexes and precision platforming. You control one of the three Warner siblings while the others follow behind, although here, they all played the same way with no unique abilities, and basically functioned as a health meter. That is, if one got hit, they were captured, but there were various ways you could bring them back. However, if all three were together, they could stack on top of each other to reach higher areas. The games were two different approaches to bringing the quirkiness of Animaniacs to video game form, and both of them pulled it off quite well while also making the games fun. Whichever version you personally preferred probably came down to which console you owned, honestly, or perhaps which style of game you liked better. Why not both? Batman, the animated series, was a game changer for the Batman franchise, giving the series a dark and stylized look, topped off by terrific voice acting and storytelling, including Kevin Conroy as Batman, Mark Hamill as the Joker, and Ron Perlman as Clayface. Eventually, the series was renamed to The Adventures of Batman and Robin during the second half of its initial run, and video games were produced bearing this moniker. Konami makes a third entry in this list, as they developed and published the SNES version, whereas the Mega Drive version was developed by Clockwork Tortoise and published by Sega. The Mega Drive version of The Adventures of Batman and Robin was a completely unique approach to a Batman game that hadn't really been done before. It essentially played somewhat like a Contra game. The player could choose to play as either Batman or Robin, or play co-op with each player taking control of one of the heroes, and the Caped Crusaders' primary attacks were ranged projectiles such as batarangs and shurikens. The action was fast-paced and frenetic, and also brutally difficult, as swarms of henchmen came at you from all directions. The art style had a somewhat different look to the TV series, though, and the soundtrack was all completely original, but still sounded great. The SNES game took a very contrasting approach. The art style, animation, and music all seemed like it was lifted straight out of the cartoon, and the game played more like a traditional action platformer with some puzzle elements, and also featured a Batmobile sequence. Batman's primary attacks were punches and kicks, and he had a host of gadgets the player could choose from, such as flashlights and bombs, to assist in completing each level. However, the game seemed to be based more on the first half of the TV series before it was renamed, as it was strictly a single-player game with Batman as the only playable character. Robin was not playable and only made some brief cameos, making the title of the game somewhat of a misnomer. Both games had their own unique interpretation of the source material, and while the Nintendo game stayed true to the animated series, the Sega game also had a lot going for it and offered a divergent experience. For those who are unaware, Shadowrun is a tabletop role-playing game in a similar vein to Dungeons & Dragons, except Shadowrun is a futuristic science fiction game combining cyberpunk and fantasy aesthetics. It centers around the players needing to conduct Shadowruns that are either physical or virtual thefts of information. It was initially invented in 1989 and remains one of the more popular tabletop RPGs. It didn't take too long before the popularity of the game inspired video games to be released on the major consoles at the time, and each system was given a unique and distinctive experience. The Genesis and SNES games were both RPGs, of course, and they were both set in Shadowrun's dystopian future and incorporated various elements from the tabletop game, but the end results were two games that were about as far apart as you could get while still remaining in the same genre with the same source material. Even the plots were totally different. The games were also not released at the same time, with the Genesis version releasing a year after the SNES version. And I deliberately say Genesis in this case, because for some reason, the Sega version only released in North America. The Genesis version was developed by Blue Sky Software and published by Sega. This was an action RPG with a top-down view and battles that happened in real time, with an open-ended world that allowed players to explore pretty much wherever they wanted. The plot also allowed the player to complete various objectives in any order they pleased. The majority of the combat is done with firearms, although if you run out of ammo, hand-to-hand combat is usually your only option. However, magic can also be used. The player can hire Shadowrunners to assist them in their missions, and can also enter and explore a global computer network called The Matrix, way before Keanu Reeves did it, which gives the game more of a third-person 3D view and simulates an act of hacking to steal data. The SNES game was developed by Beam Software and published by Data East in NTSC and Laser Beam Entertainment in PAL. This game was also an action RPG, but it had an isometric view. The world and plot were more linear in this version, generally with objectives that needed to be completed in a specific order. Combat here was also primarily done with firearms, with the assistance of magic, but there was no ammo system in place. You could also hire Shadowrunners in this game to help out with missions, and you could also explore The Matrix, although it was implemented here as more of a top-down maze of sorts. Pretty much every action in the game, from opening doors, to picking up items, to conversing with NPCs, was done with the use of a menu system. You moved a hand cursor to a certain location and pressed a button to give you options such as open, examine, pick up, or talk, and also had a more fleshed out conversation system. This is another case of whichever game you personally preferred, in all likelihood, probably came down to which console you owned. Although, if you didn't live in North America, the chances that you played the Sega version were pretty slim. Regardless, both games were critically acclaimed and both games were well received, so both are worth checking out if you are interested in RPGs or in the Shadowrun IP.
Scooby-Doo, where are you?
On the SNES and Genesis, of course. Scooby-Doo is one of Hanna-Barbera's most well-known and successful cartoons, originally airing in 1969, that featured a group of teenagers and their talking dog as they solved mysteries that usually had some kind of supernatural theme, but with a totally normal explanation. After unraveling the mystery, the monster's real identity would be exposed, who would then try to rationalize their actions. The success of the original series spawned numerous new series and spin-offs, both animated and live-action movies and video games. The specific video games we're looking at here are titled Scooby-Doo Mystery, that were two different games of the same name released on the SNES and Genesis. The basic premise of both games is more or less the same. There are mysteries to solve, and you as the player control Shaggy, with Scooby-Doo following beside you as you look for clues, while the other characters offer tips and advice. However, the execution of both of the games couldn't be any more diverse. Both games were published by Acclaim and Sunsoft. The Genesis game was developed by Illusions Gaming Company, and was actually a point-and-click adventure in the same style of games such as Monkey Island and Broken Sword. You needed to move around the nicely detailed environments looking for clues, using a command window at the bottom of the screen to select specific actions. You then needed to use the clues you had gathered in various ways in order to solve puzzles and progress the story. There were no actual enemies in the game apart from the main villain, and there was no real fear of failure. The game did an admirable job of capturing the style and humour of the show with music to match, although it did at times get somewhat frustrating as you tried to figure out exactly what you're supposed to be doing, topped off by a somewhat ridiculous 50-character password system. The SNES game, on the other hand, was an adventure platformer, and was developed by Argonaut Software. You also needed to move around the environments looking for clues, although here, the game controlled like a platformer, and it was much more obvious what the clues actually were. However, there was very little to no actual problem solving using the clues, as you just returned them to the various other members of the team who solved the puzzles. This game also had standard enemies that were scattered sporadically around the levels, that increased Shaggy's fright meter when they hit him. And if the meter filled up, he'd lose a life. This game also replicated the look and style of the show quite well, although it was missing music from the show, and was a little on the simplistic side with not a lot of variety in gameplay. For unknown reasons, not just one, but both games were only released in North America. But that's a mystery for another time. They would have gotten away with it too, if it wasn't a few meddling kids.
Scooby Dooby Doo!
Taz-Mania was a kind of odd spin-off show starring the Tasmanian Devil from Looney Tunes that aired in the early 90s, featuring Taz the Tasmanian Devil and a bunch of new characters that, like Taz, were based on Australian animals but actually had little resemblance to them, including alligators, even though Australia has crocodiles, not alligators, and kiwis, based on kiwi birds, even though kiwis are native to New Zealand. The show ran for 4 seasons, and was successful enough that it got made into video games for a number of systems, including one for the SNES and one for the Mega Drive. On the Mega Drive, Taz-Mania was a platformer, developed by Recreational Brainware and published by Sega. In the game, Taz could eat pretty much anything, and was able to gain some temporary powers by doing so. For example, eating a chili pepper allowed him to breathe fire, and eating a star gave him invincibility, although other items, such as bombs, would damage Taz if he ate them. Taz could also use his signature tornado spin to defeat enemies and gain extra jump distance. The game was pretty much a standard 2D platformer, though it did throw in some different types of levels, such as levels where you rode a minecart along the track. The SNES Taz-Mania game, though, developed by Visual Concepts and published by Sunsoft, wasn't even close to even being in the same genre. This game played kind of like a racing game. The player was given a third-person view behind Taz, and Taz ran along a road, eating things along the way. The ultimate goal of each level was to eat a certain number of kiwis within the level's time limit. On the road were various obstacles that would slow Taz down if he collided with them, and other things to eat that would restore his energy that depleted if he used his tornado spin or collided with something. At the end of the level though, Taz would go to sleep and everything he ate would escape from his mouth. Neither game really followed the show all that closely, and neither featured the show's theme song, but there was no denying that they were both very different and distinct games. Aside from featuring Taz and a few other characters from the show, the games have practically nothing in common.
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
In the 90s, few franchises were as big as Jurassic Park. Originally a novel by Michael Crichton, it was adapted into a film by Steven Spielberg, and from there exploded in popularity. It was everywhere! Naturally enough, video games were created to capitalize on the success of the film, and were released on most major systems at the time. However, pretty much all of them were different. Games were released on the NES, Master System, Game Boy, Game Gear, SNES, Mega Drive, Sega CD, Amiga, PC, and even the arcades. And aside from the Amiga and PC, and Master System and Game Gear versions, every single one of them was a separate and unique game. The NES and Game Boy were also technically the same, but still had obvious differences due to hardware limitations. Adding to the confusion was that some versions of the different games' box art shipped with screenshots on the back from other versions. Unbelievably, to date, there have been almost 40 video games in total based on the Jurassic Park IP, with no doubt more to come in the future. This list is focusing on the Mega Drive and SNES games though, so let's take a closer look at them. The Mega Drive game was developed by Blue Sky Software and published by Sega. This game was a pretty traditional side-scrolling platformer. However, in what was a unique feature at the time, the game gave you the choice to play as one of two very different characters with different goals. You could take the role of Dr. Alan Grant, who was trying to escape the island, or the role of a velociraptor who was trying to hunt down Dr. Grant. Dr. Grant was not as mobile as the raptor, but could use ranged weapons. Each character had a different set of levels to play that were designed around their abilities. The visuals in the game were impressive for the time, using silicon graphics computers similar to what was actually used in the film, and stop-motion animation that actually used some of the puppets created for the movie, so the dinosaurs all looked like they did in the film. Dr. Grant's levels picked up after the Tyrannosaurus escapes, and the raptor's level started when the power is cut and the raptors managed to escape. From there, the game doesn't really follow the plot of the movie or the level much, although it does take you to environments from each of them. Even though the game looked fantastic and had a great premise with multiple characters and endings, it fell a little flat in the actual gameplay department, mostly due to some unresponsive and imprecise controls. The SNES game was developed and published by Ocean Software. In stark contrast to the Mega Drive game, the SNES version was an open-world adventure game, allowing the player to travel pretty much anywhere they wanted right from the start. When wandering around the park in outdoor areas, the game had a top-down camera, but when the player went into building interiors, the game switched to a first-person 3D view. The game utilised digitised images of actors in the film, although the dinosaurs here didn't really look like their film counterparts, and could have been in any dinosaur game. It also claims to be the first SNES game that was mastered in Dolby Pro Logic surround sound. The game starts at some point after the dinosaurs have broken loose, and followed the basic plot of the movie somewhat loosely from there, but also included some plot elements from the novel that weren't in the film. This game also looked fantastic for its time, but it also had its shortcomings. The game offered no kind of save or password system, so it needed to be finished in one sitting, and was at least several hours long. Plus, it was pretty easy to get lost or be unsure where you're meant to be going. Hints from the other characters would also periodically pop up on screen that would sometimes obscure the action. Strangely enough, neither game featured anything from the movie's iconic soundtrack, instead both offering original soundtracks. Interestingly, both of these games received their own sequels a year later. The Mega Drive received Jurassic Park Rampage Edition that was more or less a new set of levels based off the original game, once again allowing the player to choose between Dr. Grant or a Velociraptor, although the controls here were much tighter and there were some new abilities thrown in. The SNES got Jurassic Park 2, The Chaos Continues, that had absolutely nothing in common with the first game. This was a fast-paced and painfully difficult 2D side-scrolling platform shooter that could also be played in co-op mode. So there you have it, the top 10 different games with the same name on the SNES and Mega Drive. It really is interesting to go back into video game history to take a look at games like these and realise just how different some of them were. Hopefully, you learned something from this list, and even if you didn't, you were at least entertained. For the sake of completeness, I'm including some honourable mentions here as well as in the introduction to the video. If I've missed any other notable ones, I'd love to hear about them. Drop me some comments below and give me a thumbs up if you liked the video. Thanks for watching!